Water, the beginning of our life cycle. But this film looks at a very different water cycle, one where dollars flow in place of water, where banks such as the World Bank in Washington lend money to huge projects in Africa and then demand repayments with interest, where private companies in Europe take over our water systems, selling the water back to us in return for profits, with enough spare cash to divert into Swiss bank accounts as bribes. The story takes us to Lesotho, where six dams are being constructed to quench the thirst of consumers around Johannesburg, and to the Eastern Cape towns where water has been privatized, and those other South African cities where water is being privatized and where anti-privatization struggles are emerging. And finally, to the rural areas and the cities where the poorest South Africans are dying of cholera when the price of commercialized or privatized water is pushed beyond their reach. February 2001, Johannesburg Metro Council evicts squatters from Alexandra Township. Hundreds of families have lived in shacks along the Jukske River for years. They were evicted suddenly when cholera is found in the river water, which the squatters use to wash and even to drink. Behind the headlines, the millions of South Africans still deprived of clean water and basic sanitation. A quarter of the African population live in shacks. Half have no water or electricity. 7 years after the first democratic elections, 18 million South Africans still live with inadequate sanitation. The recent cholera outbreak started in rural areas last year and was quickly transmitted through infected water supplies. In the first 10 months, 100,000 people fell ill, 200 lost their lives. Those who are infected have no clean water supply or sanitation. Some never have had. Others have taps, but cannot afford the prices the government charges to keep the water flowing now that our water is being increasingly commercialized. At the center of the epidemic, a community who used to enjoy free water, even under apartheid. But now that water is being sold to them, they have returned to the polluted streams. From rural South Africa, cholera spread quickly and inevitably to the dense urban population of Johannesburg. Here, this disease of the poor claimed four lives within sight of Johannesburg's most affluent suburb, Sandton. In Alexandra, around 300,000 people are crammed into little more than 2 square kilometers. Like most Alex residents, Sam Moilwa is unemployed. His wife Flora works in Johannesburg Airport. Johnny Mpo is an AIDS awareness trainer. Sam and Johnny were anti-apartheid activists in the 1980s in the Alexandra Civic Organization. Now the two are back in activist mode, leading a campaign against the largest dam project in Africa, the Lesotho Highlands Water Project. The campaign has taken them from Alex Township to Lesotho and into contact with environmentalists around the world. It has put them into conflict with the World Bank in Washington and with government ministers in Pretoria.
We only looked at 8 dams. That dam should be stopped immediately because it does have an impact of ordinary people.
If they could use this very same basic common sense that I'm using, they could not waste such billions of rands in Lesotho Water projects. In fact, they could be pumping all those rands into projects that uplift the standard of living of the ordinary people.
The Lesotho Highlands Water Project has been hit by constant controversy. In 1996, over 2,000 workers were fired and several shot dead by police during a strike. Basotho workers were demanding the same wage as foreigners working on the project. In 1998, South Africa sent in its air force to prop up Lesotho's military regime. The planes headed straight for the dam and killed around 20 Basotho soldiers. And in 1999, the chief executive of the project was suspended for corruption. 12 top international construction firms stand accused of paying bribes in order to win the contracts involved in the project. Amongst them, a French firm, Suez, recently awarded the contract to run Johannesburg's water supplies. The idea of a dam in Lesotho dates back to the 1950s. During the apartheid years, South Africa couldn't raise the finance. In 1986, the World Bank stepped in and established a fund in London to bypass sanctions.
On the 24th October 1986, a treaty was signed in Lesotho's capital city, Maseru.
Initially, the ANC opposed the project for strengthening apartheid, but once in government with construction underway, it changed its tune.
Mr. Mandela announced, "This is our project." It may have been an apartheid project in its conception, in its implementation. It's our project now.
The vision was ambitious. Lesotho would boost its economy by selling to South Africa its one precious resource, its white gold. But first, this tiny kingdom would need to borrow $8 billion from the world's banks, around 10 times the size of its economy. Six huge dams would be constructed in the Maluti Mountains. The water, instead of flowing south into the Free State, would flood the valleys, forming mountain reservoirs. 70 cubic meters of water per second would flow to Gauteng through 90 kilometers of tunnels under the mountains. South African consumers would repay Lesotho's loans through their water bills. In 1990, the world's top construction firms were contracted to build the dam. With the World Bank's blessing, firms from England, France, Italy, Ireland, and elsewhere had an opportunity to sidestep sanctions against South Africa. The contracts were lucrative. Phase 1A of the project was completed in 1998. At 183 meters, Katse is the highest dam in Africa.
So in case we need to discharge the water out of the dam, that's then we open the two gates.
Katse took 3 years to plan and 8 to build, using as much concrete as a four-lane highway from Johannesburg to Cape Town. The LHDA runs the project.
Every government has a responsibility. Every government must ensure that it has reliable water supplies for its population, be during times of heavy floods, heavy rainfalls, or be during times of droughts.
In 1997, ANC Minister Kader Asmal gave the go-ahead for Phase 1B of the project at Mohale.
Total amount of rockfill that will go into Mohale Dam is 7.5 million cubic meters. Half of the mountain has already been moved in.
Three more phases with a total price tag of over 30 billion rands are planned over the next 20 years.
Water as a resource is very precious. It's needed here domestically for the economy, and we've got to find water. If we don't take water, the next stage from the Lesotho Highlands, the other option is from the Tugela across the border with KwaZulu-Natal. Vaal River water has to be augmented.
Back in Alex, Sam and Johnny are not convinced.
We don't need the water from the Lesotho Highlands Water Project because we do have our own rivers in South Africa, and those rivers provide water. The only tricky question is that we South Africans, with the help of the government, should conserve this precious South African water that we have.
But most urban South Africans still live with outdated apartheid infrastructure. And in townships like Soweto and Alex, as much as half of the water leaks out through the pipes.
Leaks get the water before anyone else do. This is logical. And the leaks are not only in the small piping system that supply households, it's also in the bulk supply system. And here we're talking millions of litres of water a day.
With so much expensive water from Lesotho being wasted, Sam and Johnny wrote to the World Bank asking that they help fix the leaks before building more dams.
We went to approach World Bank because of the cost of the tariff, of water tariffs. That is also one thing, because of people must pay water tariffs to fund the Lesotho Highland Water Project.
The loan repayments for the Lesotho project have tripled water prices in Johannesburg. In many cases, poor people cannot afford their bills.
The water is limited. People don't have access to water. And that is contradictory to the constitution of South Africa, because it says water is a basic right for every human being.
At the present moment, Lesotho is delivering water, whereby South Africa is already paying. Which means the water that Lesotho is delivering at the present moment is wasted in the water, in the ground.
Sam and Johnny asked the World Bank to stop the project and fix the leaks.
We asked the World Bank particularly to stop phase 1B, which is Mohale Dam.
Sam and Johnny requested a formal investigation by the bank's inspection panel. They quoted internal bank regulations which state that reducing water demand should take priority over building new dams. The letter was sent on behalf of the civic associations of Alexandra and Soweto. But when Minister Kader Asmal found out, he wrote to civic leaders pressuring them to withdraw their complaint.
We suspect maybe there was something whereby they start to be afraid of. So to our side we say, minister or no minister, we go forward with the claim.
The World Bank had no choice but to send an official to investigate the matter. In Pretoria, some government officials have begun to look for alternatives to large dam projects. Why?
A big reason is finance, money. It costs huge amounts of money to build large dams and large transfer schemes. It is possible to make available the same amount of water by better water usage for much, much less investment, usually about one-tenth. There are environmental costs associated with building large dams and transfer schemes. There are social costs around displacement of people. All of which become very avoidable if you find alternative means of making water available in the same place.
To make way for the Katsi Dam, several thousand people were moved out of the valleys where most of the arable land is located. More are now being moved to make way for Mohale. The LHDA has a resettlement program.
People are free to choose, first of all, where they want to go. Most people will choose and to join their relatives elsewhere in the country.
But with unemployment so high in the capital Maseru and a shortage of fertile land on the high slopes, the choice is not easy. Mosoya Tota moved into a village higher up the mountain. LHDA promises food handouts for those who lose land, and a development fund has been established. One benefit often cited is the new roads constructed across the Maluti Mountains.
The treaty stipulates nobody should be worse off than they were before implementation of the project. The LHDA has gone for better off.
But this family spend their days looking down over the fields they lost to the dam.
Me tshepiso eo ile ba teng nakwana e se kae mme hona jwale re na le bothata ba ho tshela letamo tsohle ka ofela tse o re di sebedisang ngaka dinyewe mabenkele a ka nqanini.
The little ferry for these villagers was stopped due to lack of funds in this multi-billion dollar project. Ironically, the arrival of the dam has deprived these villagers of water. It's too dangerous for them to draw water from the dam, and there are no pipes running to their villages. A sharp contrast with the settlements constructed for foreign consultants building the dam. The village of Mudakadiko is in ruins. Its inhabitants have already left to make way for Mahale Reservoir. In a year's time, all of this will be underwater. One of the next villages to be evacuated is Seotsa. Downstream of the Mahale construction works, people still enjoy fast-flowing rivers. The river is their living room and bathroom. When the dam is finished, that will change, as it has changed downstream of Katse. A study of the downstream effects of the Lesotho Highlands Water Project was completed in November 1999. We obtained a copy which is clearly labelled Final Report. Its findings are shocking. Of particular concern is the treaty scenario, a projection of what will happen when all the dams are completed. Downstream, the rivers will dry up. The impact will be critically severe. The effects will be felt as far south as the Free State in South Africa.
But the water will be polluted. The fish will probably die. There will not be the vegetation that they had expected. And the implications for people will be increased disease. Implication for animals will be increased disease. It will be a lot of water flowing through a crack in the earth rather than a living river.
It seems surprising that this study was not conducted at the start of the project. Even more surprising is the fact that its findings have not been made public.
The study will be published at the right time by the parties. But it is not always advisable to publish incomplete information.
With such a devastating impact on the environment, should the project go ahead at all?
I've been persuaded that the future of the whole region, from Zambia, Malawi, Zimbabwe, Mozambique, down, depends upon a vital, healthy, expanding South African economy. And I've been told that a vital, expanding, healthy South African economy depends upon having enough water to make the industries work. Now, if that's true, then this project is justified. It's not justified, may I add, to destroy the river. What we have to do is to compromise and get a scenario which allows enough water to go through to keep the river alive. If it's not true, then the thing should be stopped.
When the Katse waters were first sent north to Johannesburg, the Vaal River was so full that it almost overflowed its banks. Although this was a rainy season, it prompted engineers in the Rand Water Board to redo their sums. Their new calculations show that at this stage, Johannesburg does not need any new dams for at least 25 years. But its waters cannot be released to quench the parched ground below, as there are no sluice gates at the bottom of the dam wall. If the white gold stockpiled in Lesotho turns out to be a burden, it is the poorest water users in South Africa who will pay. The profits of the construction firms and the repayment of the bank loans are guaranteed. Johannesburg's new water demand projections exclude water savings. If we fix the leaks and stop wasting water, we might save another 40% or more. Bearing in mind these figures, it seems very unlikely that we need any new dams. So why do we keep building them?
Dam building, firstly, belongs to a generation of people who've developed the current method of water management. It's historic. Demand management is very new. It depends on one technical decision about one intervention to put a large storage scheme somewhere, and then you have an assurance of supply. This is what we call it in the business. Water demand management, on the other hand, depends on every individual user in a system doing the right thing. It's a people-centered approach as opposed to a technical approach. There's a great safety in a technical approach. But we are in a new South Africa, where we talk about a people-centered approach for all sorts of management of systems. And water, too, is one of the systems that we need to manage with a people-centered approach.
Despite all this evidence, the World Bank eventually dismissed Sam and Johnny's claim. Sam and Johnny decided instead to take their concerns to the World Commission on Dams, a body set up to look at the pros and cons of large dam projects. Sam and Johnny teamed up with activists from Lesotho in calling for a moratorium on the Lesotho project. They took their moratorium to the launch of the World Commission on Dams in Pretoria, chaired by South African Minister Kada Asmal.
The world has built 45,000 large dams. And so today we present, believe it or not, the first comprehensive, independent and global review of dams undertaken so far. With hopes of establishing common ground in the fierce debate over dams in development and to show how to meet human needs without exhausting the resources shared by all.
My name is Sam Muilwa, an ordinary resident in Alexandra. We are affected directly as low-income residents of Alexandra. My question is it not feasible or wise to now consider and re-evaluate the demand-side options before the continuation of the Lesotho Highlands Water Project?
Everything we say is for the future. We only looked at 8 dams systematically. We didn't look at Lesotho because we chose the Kariba.
Asmal said that the commission was there to develop general guidelines and had not examined the Lesotho project directly. And although the commission supported demand management, Asmal was still not convinced by Sam and Johnny's concerns.
The World Bank inspection rejected the complaints made that they were, the South African government had done things transparently. I mean, you know, there was this independent assessment about phase 1B. But the importance of the report is that the report makes recommendations about dams which are now in the pipeline. And then, of course, demand management is very important. You can't have alternatives when the project is already in being.
So construction work continues at Mahale. No companies have been suspended for corruption. Several of the existing contractors have been hired to draw up detailed plans for the remaining phases. With so much invested in the project and so much profit at stake, has the project gathered its own unstoppable momentum?
Well, phase two, as it's called, of the Lesotho Highland scheme is not writ in stone. That's something that has to be considered. 1A and B, which is Katsi and Mahale, Mahale's still being constructed. That's fait accompli. I believe it's done a tremendous amount for Lesotho and for South Africa.
How can a big project like this happen in Lesotho, whereas people around those projects, they don't have access to water? For instance, even people from Alexander, they don't have even access to water.
We say the World Bank and the South African government just stop this Lesotho Highlands water project and concentrate on uplifting the standard of living of the people. So from now on, we are going to network more with the NGOs, the CBOs of Lesotho and of Alexandra or Gauteng. And then we are going to proceed with this battle, and we are going to win it.
While Sam and Johnny fight against the Lesotho project, communities around the country are fighting for access to water. In Mpumalanga Township in Durban, residents are opposed to the introduction of water meters. Metering water is the first step towards privatization. Meters allow those who do not pay or cannot pay to be disconnected. Residents are asserting their constitutional right to water.
People are dying now because of hunger, because they are starving, because of poverty. They are dying. We are burying more than 20 people a weekend. More than 20 people. The graveyard, they are saying now we must burn people now because the graveyard, no more land to bury people. But we are killing people. We are killing people by installing things which are not going to work. Even this idea of putting meters is a waste of time, because about 80% of the people can't afford to pay for those meters. And then at the end of the day, it will be useless. It's a waste of money, the idea of installing meters. I'm telling you, I'm living in this township.
Water is the beginning of our life. We cook with water. We wash with water. We keep ourselves and our houses clean with water. If we don't have water, we will have diseases. We will be unhealthy. So water is an essential lifeblood. We must have water. And if the water, if you can't afford to pay for it, and if you have it for nothing, you have to have it for nothing. The government can't tell us that it hasn't got the money, because we know it has got the money. What is wrong is that the government does not know how to budget. All the money that it is wasting on armaments, that it is wasting on fancy aeroplanes to fly ministers around. We want it back. Amanjila. Amanjila.
In Johannesburg last year, protesters gathered to oppose the privatization of the city's water as part of the Egoli 2002 program. Based on evidence from around the world, they argued that privatization will lead to job losses, higher prices, and poor services.
I will leave the audience to listen to the rationalizations, evasions, and I'm sure blatant lies as they justify corruption and trying to buy our water resources. For us, the working class of South Africa, water is a basic necessity. It is a human right, but for these gentlemen here, it's a commodity, a chance for them to make money. So really, this is like trying to mix water and oil. Gentlemen, enjoy the water. Pants with privatization, pants!
Johannesburg went ahead with the commercialization of water. The contract to manage the Joburg water utility for the first 5 years was awarded to Water Services South Africa, a subsidiary of the French company Suez, one of the same companies constructing the Lesotho Dam. Suez is the largest private water company in the world. It operates in 120 countries with an annual income of around $30 billion, around the same amount as the South African government budget. Suez makes no bones about its mission. Asked how confident he is about the future of the water industry, Suez chairman Gerard Mestre said, "Water is a product which normally would be free, and our job is to sell it, but it is a product which is absolutely necessary for life." He went on, "Suez was founded on a philosophy of conquest, and we have to develop that philosophy in our group. If we succeed, we shall be in harmony with our world history and our culture." Suez is one of five or six huge players in the global water and wastewater industry, which will soon be worth $1 trillion. Its first South African privatizations were in the 1980s in Eastern Cape towns, where it turns over a handsome profit whilst many township residents still go thirsty. In the recent municipal elections, the government promised to provide free water and electricity. Yet this promise seems like a remote dream for half the population living in the poorest municipalities. For now, it seems that the poorest South Africans will continue to be asked to pay for white gold or be left without the basic means to live.